I've heard too many horror stories about music producers, so in this video, I want to put an end to it and protect your future music. Opening remarks. Your songs are important. They're a piece of you, a part of your story, your journey, and they're gonna be with you forever. So putting that into somebody's hands can be a daunting task. So take these red flags in and make sure that you keep them in mind for the next time you're looking for a music producer for your project. The red flags. Number one, no website or place to learn about them. So as a rule of thumb, if somebody doesn't have either a website or at minimum a SoundCloud or Spotify playlist of their work, that can be a big red flag that they do not take themselves seriously. This is the first qualifier if you're gonna consider working with a producer, do they sound good? So if they aren't able to provide you with a centralized place to hear some of their work, that could be a very easy indicator that they're not serious and could be a bad option for you. The one caveat to keep in mind is that if they're super new and just looking to get experience and taking little or no pay, they may not have this portfolio and you could be part of that portfolio. But for the most part, if you're serious about your music, you're gonna wanna make sure they have a centralized website or portfolio to look through. Number two, the general specialist. It can be a red flag if the person you're approaching is a pop specialist, but they're also a metal specialist, a jazz specialist, a rock specialist. They also do dance choreography and they design websites. The odds that this person is great at every single one of those things is super, super slim, and more likely they're gonna be all right at a lot of different things, which again is okay depending on how seriously you might wanna take this next release. But if you're really looking to go ahead, make sure that it's the best it can be. You're probably going to want to find somebody who does exactly what you're looking for, and that's all they do. Number three, overly pushing to close the sale. This is about you and your music. This is not about a producer getting a gig so they can pay their rent. If they are seemingly desperate and trying to really close the sale for no reason beyond getting the money, that could be a sign that their true motives may not be aligned with you having the best product and being the right fit for the project. Number four, only fixated on budget. This is always a really difficult, sometimes uncomfortable question to discuss, and that is money. I actually do recommend that artists or anybody who's looking to hire a creative service professional have an idea of a ballpark of what they could feasibly afford. It's going to both help yourself and the producer be able to map that budget into where you're looking to go with it and use it effectively. But the thing can be, if they come in and the first question is off the top of the head, what's your budget? And that's the only thing that they're fixated on. It can be really uncomfortable. And again, I question the motives of, are they here to genuinely help the music, or are they here trying to see how much money that they can get out of you? If you're unsure where you're gonna start with your budget, you can always come back with a genuine question and say, hey, I'm honestly not sure where I should be looking as far as an investment. Could you give me a ballpark estimate of what we're looking at here? This way, it leaves it open to at least a range of what you can expect, and then honing it in further from what your needs are in your specific project. Number five, unable to answer business questions clearly. This is super, super common. People are service providers, but they're not necessarily great at business, and that can cause a lot of confusion. You wanna be sure that you know exactly what you're paying for, what comes with it, what doesn't it include, when are you going to get it, and everything else along those lines. So if they aren't able to define exactly what you're paying for and what exactly they're gonna do and give to you at the end, yike. And one quick thing, this doesn't just have to do with money. This could be just questions in general about their process or anything that they kind of just keep giving you vague placations back, like, oh, you know I got your back, don't worry about it. Oh, don't worry about that, yeah, I'll take care of it. What does taking care of it mean? It's like, great, but what does that mean? Because I want to make sure if I'm giving you, again, $4,000, that I know exactly what I'm going to get for my money. Number six, they do business on handshakes and verbal agreements. Paperwork discussion. This doesn't have to be anything fancy, but if somebody says that they're gonna do thousands of dollars or even hundreds of dollars of work for you and not wanna put anything in writing, that is a big, big red flag. Anybody who's providing a service, even if they're doing it for free, it's so important to have this in place. And I don't mean, you know, PDF documents that are reviewed by a legal team. It doesn't have to be any kind of a crazy business template. I mean, it can even be as simple as sending an email and then saying, hey, if you're on board with this scope of the project, just respond like I'm on board and we're good. That can at least show the intent and the general agreement to the set of terms in the email. This is not, like, I'm not a lawyer, but I've had to small claims a couple of things. And don't worry, emails are very, very helpful in showing that. Number seven, they use sketchy payment methods. I'm sure you've been there before, you've worked with a producer and they say, oh, just Venmo me a few hundred bucks and then we'll get started. And that is not terrible, but what people don't realize is that paying an invoice as a business transaction through something like PayPal offers you buyer protection. And what that means is if this producer flakes on you, they ghost on you, they don't complete the project, any kind of issues, you can dispute that with PayPal and submit the evidence that you did not get the service that you paid for. Paying as friends and family on PayPal, through Zelle, through Venmo, any kind of personal way, and of course, weird like wire transfers or like, a check, these things don't have any kind of protection for you as the musician, as the artist working with the producer. So I would just say ask to do it through the normal PayPal invoicing channels. That's completely okay to do. I understand it can be hundreds and hundreds of dollars in fees, but if they say no and they say no, it's gotta be friends and family, you are not protected for that purchase. So if they screw you over, there's nothing you can do. So please, please watch out. Number eight, they have no people skills or a bad temper before the project even starts. This one's pretty self-explanatory. People are supposed to be on their best behavior when trying to sell, trying to pitch themselves, trying to, first impressions. And if they are a crabby fart person from day one, you have to be aware of that before you commit to spending 60 to 80 hours in a box with them. Again, this doesn't mean that somebody crabby doesn't do a great job and isn't worth working with, but if that's important to you and you want to make sure there's a great energy in the environment when you're having your song worked on, keep that in mind. These initial impressions are often indicative of what's to come. Number nine, they won't speak on a phone or video call about your project. For any large project, if you are spending money on it and they won't speak to you, they won't take the time to call you on the phone or video call you, that is probably a sign that it isn't a priority for them. And that isn't their fault and it isn't your fault, but it just represents the amount that they care about that project. Again, I get it. A lot of producers are super busy, so they might send you some information, send you an estimate, send you a quote, however they might want to do it. But if you say, I'd love to talk about it further, and then they say that they're too busy for it, is somebody who's too busy to spend 15 minutes on the phone worth you spending hundreds or thousands of dollars on? Probably not. Number 10, they fixate on their greatness, not your music. There is a ton of narcissism and self-absorbed behavior in the music business, and there is no shortage of that with music producers. Well, of course, there's an element of making sure that they demonstrate that they have authority, the clout or reputation, all these kinds of things. It shouldn't feel like that they are superhero coming in to save you as a damsel in distress, that they're the only hope for you and your music. Again, a producer plays a role of helping somebody get from point A to point B with their music. It's not them coming in to save your life and just, oh, you're so blessed to be able to have their presence for even a moment. So make sure that in the conversations, it's not so much skewed about them, and it should of course be about you. They are here to help your music be the best that it can be. And so the conversation should be about that and not just how many times I want to mention the album that they were assistant engineer on 12 years ago for a half day. Closing thoughts. You have a lot of options in the marketplace when it comes to music producers. So to think that one person is the person you have to work with to get a great product for your music is just a bad scarcity mindset. When there are plenty of people who would be more than happy to sit down with you, discuss things, have a great, clear, and concise discussion, and then see if it's a good fit and move forward from there. So don't be stuck with somebody just because that you think that this is the one person. I promise they aren't. These are, again, just things to keep in mind that can save you a lot of headache, problems, and turmoil down the road. Full disclaimer, I am a music producer and mixing engineer as my career, so I don't want this to come off slanted, but these are just genuine tips that can really help you when shopping for any producer in the marketplace. If you enjoy this video, I'm sure that you're gonna love this one here, or perhaps this one over here as well. I'm sure you subscribed and that you liked the video. Much love. See you next time. It's like a kitty. You have meow.